we dive into the scriptures today, I need to share something from my that's happening in my personal life that's going to affect our church somewhat, actually very positively. But you just need to know. When we made the turn into 2013, I realized that something of my own energy level was being depleted. And I can't believe I've made it this long. As you know, we merged, those of you who are here for the first time, the context is a year and a half ago, back in 2012, we merged churches in a missional kind of way to create a two-campus church, one church, two locations. Remember that? So we came through 2012, I think, with all the factors that were involved, we came through great. We were at, we were in the black, so to speak. We actually grew a little bit financially, grew a little bit attendance-wise. We had the most people that had ever come to Jesus in one year in the history of our church, 2012. I think that was the way, it was God's way of saying, I approve of what you're doing. Well, 2013 hit around Easter time this past year. I began to realize that my own just energy level, my own just emotional energy began to just be drained. You know how it is, like they tell you, when you, in order to manage stress well, you got to go do something that you really love doing and it fills your tank, right? For some of you, you know what your tank-filling activities need to be. And so I would go back and do my tank-filling activities, whatever, go exercise, you know, go spend time with the kids, go be alone for a little bit, that kind of stuff. But I realized, since Easter, every time I go try to fill the emotional tank, like, the very next moment, it would just be drained. It's like there's a hole in my tank. So I finally began to communicate this to our staff and our team, and they said, Pastor, we can see it, we can feel it, you need to take a break. I went to my district supervisor and I said, Tim, I need to take a break. And in the scripture, in the Bible, in the Old Testament, God told his people that every 7 years you need to let the land rest. They said, don't farm on it, don't cultivate it, don't do anything on it. Just let it grow. Just whatever comes up, just leave it alone. There's a reason for that. Because the land, after it's bearing fruit over some time, the land needs time to replenish its nutrients. Otherwise, you'll basically rip the land, rake the land free of all its good soil and nutrients. In a similar fashion, I felt like lately God is leading, has been leading me into a time of rest, where I need to let the soil of my heart and soul replenish. And I'm not talking about a vacation, okay? Because a couple Sundays ago at Harbor City, I made the same announcement, and people were coming up to me afterwards going, have a great vacation, Pastor. This is not vacation. This is an intentionalized period of rest for me to reset some important rhythms in my life. And I'm talking about things like eating, sleeping, and exercising, and spending time with Jesus. Okay? That's pretty much it. And spending time with family, of course. So there's going to be some aspects of that. But the Lord is, about 2 months ago, I felt like I needed to do this. I just didn't know when, and I didn't know how long. So I've been praying about it, and about 3 weeks ago, the Lord spoke to me very clearly in my devotion time. And it was out of a passage in Exodus where Moses goes up to the mountain, and God says, hey, come up to the mountain, but bring the elders with you, and bring Aaron and Hur and all these other guys. And so he comes up to the mountain, and they are at the side of Mount Sinai, like fellowshipping, eating, drinking, just having a party in the presence of God. And then in that context, the Lord then speaks even more clearly to Moses, and he says, now Moses, now you come up. You come up alone. And Moses says, Moses climbs the mountain, and he goes to be alone with God. And he's there for 40 days and 40 nights. And when I read that passage, I felt the Spirit prompt me that this needs to be a 40-day period. So I said, okay, I'll do that. I'll climb the mountain, whatever that looks like, whatever that means. For me, it really means just getting some rest, just letting my soul replenish, just reconnecting with wife and kids and family and stuff that makes us human beings. Because I think that's important. And believe it or not, it's really for you. You're going to get the best version of me if I'm well rested. And our church will be able to have the best version of Ken Bringus leading the way. Does that make sense? Okay, so By way of information, that period of rest is going to begin July 1st for me. July 1st all the way through August 11th. I'm taking a 40-day, I call it a mini sabbatical. That's a period of replenishing my life and my soul. And what that means for you is, first of all, this, that I need you to be praying for me. You can call me if you want, but you might not get a call back. You can email me, you might not get a response. You can even try to Facebook me or Instagram me, and you just might not get a response. But in light of that, you just need to know you are well taken care of. I told Harbor City this. I said, you know, if you don't feel taken care of as a part of this congregation, it's not because we don't have enough people and enough pastoral presence here. If you don't feel taken care of, there's something else going on. But you need to know that there is an eldership in place. There are pastors on staff that are here to respond to your needs. And if the church ever runs into problems that team cannot handle, our district, Tim Clark, his district team, are ready to respond to anything that we can't handle during the time that I'm away. All right, so I'm still senior pastor. Say hi, senior pastor. All right, just want to make sure that you know. All right, and I know that many of you are going, what's going on? There's a lot more clarity that's coming, trust me. But I'm still senior pastor here. I'm releasing leadership in the place, and you're doing just fine. Okay, so put your hand in your heart. You're going to do just fine. Yeah. And pastor's going to have a good sabbatical because of your prayers and because of all the support that's coming through this way. All right, so if you have any questions for me, I'd love to talk to you about it in detail after the service. You know me by now. I'm not one to make it look like things are okay when they're not. I'm pretty vulnerable, I'm pretty open, I'm pretty transparent. So I'd love to entertain your questions and thoughts about all of this. But more than anything, need your prayers. My wife and I need your prayers. We've been doing great. You know, marriage goes like this sometimes. Amen, married couples? Yeah, and sometimes the secret to staying faith, to staying true, really, is remembering that your vows are spoken first to God, as well as to your spouse. And so when all else seems to be breaking down, remember, we're faithful to God first, right? And so my wife and I have been doing really great. My wife was here last week, as I told her, she was like in her supermodel type of, outfit. Like, yes. So things are going good, and that's happening. So thank you for your prayers. But that's what's going to happen. You're not going to see me around in July and in the first week of August. Say amen. Yeah, because what I realized? That sometimes when I'm away, the church actually does better. Don't ask me why that is. I think it's God's way of just saying it doesn't depend on you, Tammy. And our vision here has been to raise up leaders, has been to develop leaders. Whether we do it in an intentionalized, programmatic, systematic way or not, it doesn't matter. Jesus didn't say, start a program. He said, make disciples. And so however it gets done, we're committed to doing it. And the people that are here taking care of you, the people you've seen come up in ranks and leadership, these are the folks we're saying, man, God's anointing, God's call is on them, and we want to see that happen more and more in the life of our church. Yes? Yeah. Amen. Okay, let's dive into the scriptures. Hey, take out your Bibles this morning, and if you have them, if you don't have them, we have conveniently made the passage we're going to study today available on the PowerPoint, or the keynote, the screen up there. Let me start out by giving you kind of a scenario. If you were to be like on the surface of the moon and looking down on the earth, okay? Or if you were, let's say, in one of those satellite space stations that was above the atmosphere of the earth and looking down on the earth, you would see the dark outline of the land against the blue oceans of earth, right? Imagine that picture. You would see the whirling masses of clouds, cloud formations. You begin to make out the formation of mountain ranges and deserts and polar ice caps. Okay? And then, if you look a little closely, at the Asian continent in particular, you would see this line sort of snaking through the center of that continent. And you would probably recognize it as a man-made structure. How many of you know what that man-made structure would be? The great, yeah, the great. It just so happened that it would be the Great Wall of China. So from the deep heavens, far above the earth, you can see the globe and everything that God has created from a new perspective. Except for the one thing that human beings made, which just so happens to be a wall. Interesting. And this really shouldn't surprise us because we have always been expert wall builders. As the human race, we know very well how to build walls in more ways than one. Now, walls can be a good thing when they're seen as healthy boundaries, right? When they protect, when they define, when they give structure. They can be boundaries that can help us define our identity. But the sad thing is that we've learned how to build walls in a negative way. We've learned how to build walls that separate and divide unnecessarily. Walls that support the wrong kinds of attitudes and perspectives about God and others. Walls that allow us to enforce our pride, enforce our ethnocentrism, enforce our prejudice, and justify our prejudice towards others who are different from us. You talk about them as racial walls, political walls, like economic walls, cultural and historical walls of hostility and animosity, walls of imperialism, walls of oppression, walls of separation and superiority based on ideology, based on race, based on class, based on religion. And here's the tragedy, perhaps more than any other institution that has built walls like this, the church has led the way in this effort. Now, this hasn't always been the case. In church history, there are very inspiring stories of men and women who refused to build those walls. Folks like Bonhoeffer in Nazi Germany refusing to accept Hitler's racial agenda. Desmond Tutu, Nelson Mandela in South Africa, leading a divided nation back towards unity. Billy Graham in Atlanta, personally removing the physical barrier that separated blacks and whites at his very crusade that night. Even in our own denomination, Foursquare, some of you don't know this, Amy Semple McPherson, the woman who founded this movement, back in the day when she was running crusades in places where white supremacy was very strong. There was a story about her in one of her meetings where the Ku Klux Klan showed up in her meetings and filled a whole section. They found out later that she actually welcomed them. Come on over. And guess what happened in the meeting? All of them were hit by the power of God and left their hoods behind, literally. And so we have this history of good stuff that's happened in the life of the history of the church. But here's the thing is, I just don't feel, as you look back at everything, that there's just not enough of these stories. There's just not enough of this happening. Now granted, man, some of the walls that the church built, metaphorically speaking, figuratively speaking, are necessary, right? We need clarity, we need definition, we need walls, so to speak, on core doctrine. We need clarity on doctrinal issues, on issues about, you know, especially nowadays, on the biblical stance on marriage, right? We need issues when it comes to, you know, standards for sexual behavior, things like that. We need clarity, we need definition. I get that. The problem is this: God's people throughout history often break down the wrong walls. And we tear down the walls that God has established as boundaries, healthy boundaries. Or we try to scale those walls, right? And on the opposite end, we build up the walls that God is wanting to break down. It's the problem. So in the passage that we're dealing with today, Ephesians chapter 2, verse 11 to 22, Paul speaks to us and to the Ephesian churches about a great wall that has separated Jew and Gentile. And he tells us in this passage that this wall has been destroyed, and as a result of this wall being destroyed, a radical new vision of the church can emerge. So, in this text, if you're taking notes, we're going to see a snapshot of Paul's vision for the church. He's going to begin with a little more intentionality, giving us his perspective on the nature of the church. And here, he emphasizes that the church and the nature of the church and his vision for it is one of inclusion. Say inclusion. Reconciliation. And peace. So let me kind of ramp up into this with a little context. I think it's arguable, okay? But I think that there's significant evidence in the letter here that the Ephesian churches were a racially diverse congregation. Throughout Paul's message here, he uses inclusive language. And if you look back in the book of Acts and you study how the church in Ephesus came about, there are a couple of passages that stand out. When Paul is teaching in the lecture hall of Tyrannus in Acts chapter 19, it says that all of Asia eventually heard the word of the Lord. Now watch the emphasis in the text, both Jews and Greeks. And then further down in Acts chapter 19, it talks about how the name of the Lord Jesus was magnified amongst both Jews and Greeks who lived at Ephesus. So it's very likely that the church in Ephesus was an unusual eclectic blend, reflecting a racial diversity that was unparalleled at that time. And maybe Paul had seen evidence that the gospel had the power to keep together both Jewish Christians and Gentile Christians under the same roof, worshiping together, loving one another in spite of their differences. Maybe Paul saw that. It's probably the reason why the language in the Ephesian letter is very, very inclusive. In chapter 1, he says, all believers have been blessed with every spiritual blessing in Christ. All believers have been given the Holy Spirit as a deposit, guaranteeing what is to come. When he prays for the Ephesians in chapter 1, verse 15, he says, man, having heard of your faith and love for all the saints, all the believers, I don't cease giving thanks for you. So you get a lot of inclusive language here. I think the church in Ephesus was a racially diverse blend of Jew and Gentile. Multiracial congregation that obviously was facing some of the unique challenges of how do we worship together as one, right? You know, it's like they tell you in a wedding, you know, God is making the two, husband and wife, one, right? And the big question is, well, which one? Which one are you going to be more like? Right? That's where the tensions are. God is making us one, yeah, but which one? Jew or Gentile? Are you more Jewish or Gentile? Those are issues that the church, the early church, struggled with for the longest time, and still today does. In fact, as Christianity started out, it started out in Jerusalem, right? Jesus said, hey, the Holy Spirit's going to come, and it's going to start in Jerusalem. But the point of it starting in Jerusalem is for it to spread into Judea, Samaria, and eventually to the ends of the earth. So when Christianity starts out, it starts out as a movement of Jewish Christians. It is wedded to its cultural Jewish roots. But as Christianity moves beyond Jerusalem, it starts to look more and more different. And there were people on one side of the spectrum that were saying, hey, wait a second, man. What happened to our Jewishness? And they would go around to different places where Christianity was spreading, and they would say, hey, all you Gentile Christians, you need to become circumcised. Now, in case you didn't know, circumcision was one of the signs of the covenant as a Jew. Like, if you wanted to be a part of the people of God, this was just something you did. Guys did. And so they would have these guys going around to different places, following Paul around, going, no, you received Jesus, yeah, but you haven't been circumcised. Well, your salvation isn't complete. Try that out today, man. That would just not fly, would it, right? Try having an altar call like that. You know Jesus? Yeah, I know Jesus. Well, your salvation isn't complete until you're circumcised. How many want to raise their hands today? So, but this is a very real tension. The question really was, how Jewish do I need to become in order to be a faithful Christian? So these guys are preaching that circumcision message. We're saying, you got to be circumcised at the very least, and maybe obey some of the law too. But you get Paul on the other end of the spectrum. Now listen, Paul is way more radical than the book of Acts lets us know. Paul's saying, no way, faith in Jesus Christ alone justifies you. Circumcision? Tell those guys who are saying you got to be circumcised that you might as well go all the way and emasculate yourself. That's in the Bible, by the way. Paul is rigidly against all that stuff. You don't have to become a Jew to become a Christian. It's a big issue. So what Paul seems to be articulating here is perhaps his most profound understanding of the nature of the church. That the church can actually be a place where Jew and Gentile learn to live and love and worship together and be shaped into this new humanity and this community that reflects the beauty of the kingdom of God, the multiracial and cultural diversity of God's kingdom. And so in chapter 2, verse 11, he starts to unfold his understanding of the true nature of the church. He says, therefore, in light of what I just told you, which we won't go over today, he says, remember that formerly you who were Gentiles by birth and called uncircumcised, I know where that comes from, by those who call themselves the circumcision, which is the Jewish folk, which is done in the body by human hands. So he's not talking about a figurative circumcision. He's talking about a real circumcision. It's a real deal. He says, remember that at that time you were separate from Christ, excluded from citizenship in Israel and foreigners to the covenants of the promise, without hope and without God in the world. So God starts out choosing a community, choosing a people that we call the Jewish people, the Hebrews. And he says, it's through this community that I want to show my glory in the world. So the first half of their history, God is establishing, setting up boundaries, setting up their identity in him. Part of that was to establish them as covenant people. And the sign of the covenant was circumcision. That was the big one, at least. Now, interestingly enough, later on, when Jewish Christianity starts to come into play, baptism replaces circumcision as the sign of the covenant. But here, Paul is referring to the Gentiles. You guys were excluded. You were not included in that whole deal. But he says, but now, verse 13, in Christ Jesus, you who were once far away have been brought near by the blood of Christ. Now watch. This is how this has happened. Jesus himself is our peace, who has made the two groups, Jew and Gentile, one, and has destroyed the what? The barrier. What is that barrier? Well, he says, the dividing wall of hostility. By setting aside in his flesh, in the cross, the law with its regulations and its commandments. Let's keep going. His purpose was to create in himself one new humanity out of the two, thus making peace, and in one body to reconcile both of them to God through the cross by which he put to death their hostility. Verse 17. He came and he preached peace to you who were far away and peace to those who were near. And the implication there is not Jesus directly doing that, but through the apostles and prophets, he has come and preached to you. He says, for through him, we both have access to the Father by one Spirit. Consequently, you are no longer foreigners and strangers, but fellow citizens with God's people and also members of his household, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the chief cornerstone. Now watch. In him, the whole building is joined together and rises to become a holy temple in the Lord. And in him, you too are being built together to become a dwelling in which God lives by his Spirit. And the Lord bless the reading of his word. In this passage, there's a lot to unpack here. I want to focus on a few things here. Paul is making some pretty powerful statements about the nature of the church. The people of God. The word in Greek is ekklesia. It's an ekklesia. Ekklesia. We're not going to do a full-on word study, but know that the word is used by Paul in the letter about three times or so. But he is talking about this ekklesia, this called-out community. That is, he's saying, this is the church, and I want to explain to you something about the nature of this thing we call the ekklesia, the church. Those people who believe in Jesus and claim him as Savior and Lord. Let me tell you three things about this community. The first thing is, this community, the church, the ecclesia, the body of Christ,
is a peacemaking body. And Jesus himself is our example. He is our peace. Now, I want you to catch the irony in this passage, right? It says, he is our peace who has destroyed something. He has removed something. See, we tend to think of peace as the absence of war, as the absence of destructiveness or conflict. And for some of us who come from Asian cultures, some of us think of peace as just avoiding conflict. And avoid conflict, and you'll experience peace. But look at what Jesus, the peacemaker, does. It says he fuses two groups of people together, and then he destroys a barrier that's called here the dividing wall of hostility, and he makes peace between them and God and them and each other. Sometimes in order to make peace, you've got to engage in a little destructiveness. There's two sides to it, right? Something you've got to tear down for there to be true peace. Now watch. The barrier that Jesus destroys here is called the dividing wall of hostility. And that dividing wall of hostility is connected somehow to the law and its regulations. What in the world is going on here? I think it's important to understand the context here when it comes to Jew and Gentile relations. Because he calls it dividing wall of hostility. There's some interpretation debate about what really that is. But understand that Jews and Gentiles, in terms of their general relations with each other, they're kind of like oil and water, all right? They just didn't mix. Jews grew up calling Gentile, names, dogs, whatever. I mean, they understood themselves as, if we were the covenant people of God, everyone else on the outside, they're Gentile. And it's not necessarily a bad thing. It wasn't like intentional, we were just going to spite Gentiles for spiting. No, this is just kind of evolved in their mentality. They saw Gentiles as unclean because, God sets up laws and you obey those laws and you are ritually clean. People who don't obey those laws aren't, i.e. the Gentile world. So as a Jew, as a good Jew, you don't step into a Gentile's house and share a meal with them without becoming ritually impure. As a good Jew, you just didn't eat Gentile food, right? You had a kosher diet. You didn't listen to Gentile music. And you didn't marry Gentile women. And in general, you just didn't worship at the Gentile pagan temples. When it came to lifestyle, man, and how Jews and Gentiles understood their place in the world, those two things couldn't have been more different. I mean, how would you know if someone was a Jew back then? Well, you could watch how they lived, if they didn't eat certain things, right? Where they worship. And if you still couldn't tell after that, you just have to say, well, are you circumcised or not? It's the bottom line. Because if you're circumcised, you're most likely a Jew. And that's the thing. When Paul says here, he says, remember how you, who are Gentiles by birth and called uncircumcised, right, by these who call themselves the circumcision. I find that interesting because that was the common way Jews and Gentiles referred to each other. The circumcision and the uncircumcision. Let's say if this side of the sanctuary was Jewish, we would call you the circumcision. This side was Gentile, we'd call you the uncircumcised. So you can imagine little Johnny Jew, right? In his high school, looking across the quad with his Jewish friends and going, "Tah, look at those uncircumcised over there." And then you can see him walking through the hallway, right? And you can see one Gentile dude walking past Johnny going, "Hey, what's up, Mr. Circumcised?" And then Johnny Jew going, "What's up, Mr. Uncircumcised?" It's like very uncouth, right? It's like so barbaric. Those are common ways that they understood each other. I get it. And you just gotta, it doesn't sound respectful, man, but there was some historical just tension between these two races, these two groups. And part of what I think shaped that tension was the law. Not just the Ten Commandments, okay? But in the history of Judaism, the Ten Commandments was just the beginning of the law. They have this thing called, it's the rabbinical Bible, really. It's called the Talmud. And the Talmud is like oral tradition put into writing. It was the interpretation of all the laws that God gave to Moses, the main laws. You have all these other laws that the Jewish community creates, the rabbis create. They put it in writing because they want to preserve it, and they call it the Talmud. Now, it just so happened at the time in history when the Talmud is being put into writing, okay, it's the time in history when Israel is being taken over by the Greek Empire, Alexander the Great. Now, this was serious stuff, okay, because the Greeks did not treat the Jews very well. In fact, they forced them to worship their pagan gods. I mean, they did things like, you know, Greek generals would burst in on a Jewish wedding and they would rape the bride in front of everybody. I mean, that was the kind of stuff that was going on. The Jews hated the Greeks. The Greeks hated the Jews. And in this historical context, they're writing the Talmud, the interpretation of the law. So you can imagine when you open up the Talmud and you read a bunch of stuff about how Jews relate to Gentiles, there's a lot of nasty stuff in there. It's pretty bad. It's like, wow, the Jews get so much hatred toward the Gentiles. Well, remember, this is happening at a time when there are terrible things happening to the Jewish community because of Gentile oppression. And then when the Romans come and take power, it gets a little more civilized, but not that much. Romans still force the Jews to worship their gods, to worship Caesar as Lord. And so they're going, what is going on here? There is a historical tension, historical animosity between Jew and Gentile here. And you can find even some of the traces of this sort of ethnocentrism happening that's built into the life of the Jewish temple. When Herod rebuilt the temple in Jesus' time, they had a courtyard that was normally called the outer court. They renamed the court of the Gentiles. I mean, to say, in this big outer court, the Gentiles can go, but you don't go any further than this outer court. So you can come and you can kind of experience and see what's going on from a distance, but you cannot participate in the full worship of God. This court is where you remain. That's what the architecture, that's the message that the architecture sends, is you're limited to this place and this alone. You can't fully worship in God's presence. So you can see how historically this is playing out. And Paul here is about to address this, dividing wall of hostility. Because in the temple, you know, one interpretation of this says that in the temple courts, the wall that divided the outer court, the court of the Gentiles, and the rest of the temple, some people think that that was the wall that Paul is referring to here, a very physical structure. You can see it. This is a wall of separation. And it sends the message, you cannot fully enter the presence of God. You can worship at a distance, maybe check it out a little bit. Unless, maybe get circumcised and we'll talk. So you get it. There are these divisive things happening. And the context of this, Paul speaks and he says, hey, in the minds of Paul's readers, they're probably thinking, man, you know, this dividing wall of hostility could refer to some of the hostile attitudes we've had, or that Jews have had towards us, or that we've had towards the Jews, this separatist mentality, this conscious superiority that we've exercised over the years. And the fact that these attitudes are somewhat enforced by the Jewish interpretation of the law. Paul says, in the middle of all of this, Jesus has come as the Prince of Peace, and he has torn down this wall. How has he done it? Through the cross, his broken body on the cross. You see, because making peace, folks, sometimes requires the violence of love. Tearing things down, destroying things that are hindering true peace. True peace is not an absence of conflict. You may think you have peace, but in the end, what you really have, if the walls are still up, what you really have is a friendly tolerance towards each other. I think that's as far as the world can go, honestly. You know, in our multicultural society, everybody's trying to prop up their own culture. Yeah, Asian Americans, yeah, African Americans, yeah, Latinos, yeah, you know, and all of this stuff. And it goes even further than that. And then we're trying to make peace with each other. Do you see that really happening? Oh, yeah, we get along. Me and my friends, we get along. Yeah, that's cool. Maybe in the second generation, whatever. But listen, the world can go only so far. In fact, I would venture to say that the world can only achieve a friendly tolerance towards each other.
in light of all of these class, racial, gender differences, generational differences, friendly tolerance. Paul's saying the Church of Jesus Christ is to model something more than friendly tolerance. That in our community life, we are to model a peace that comes from the Prince of Peace that breaks down the walls of separation between us. Now listen, that peace comes from the Hebrew notion of peace, which is shalom. Peace, the word peace, is a loose translation of shalom. Because shalom is more than just the absence of conflict. Shalom has to do with wellness and wholeness, has to do with everything in its right place, in its proper order, working in the right way. In the world, in our relationships, it's a big idea. And God says, this is what I want to see in the world. This is what the body of Christ is called to demonstrate in its community life. That's it. The church is a body of peace makers. And our cultural differences, let me say it this way for this church, our generational differences. Wasn't that great to see three generations of women singing up here?
Yes.
I know that some of you weren't thinking about those differences. But let me tell you, I want to show it to you. That's important. All those differences that can easily drive division and divide us. Paul says you need to see past that and create a community because of Jesus who's making peace, who's removed those walls of separation, where all of us learn how to love one another in spite of and beyond our differences. Cultural, generational, gender, etc. By the way, if you want to apply this more broadly, how many of you know that marriage is a cross-cultural relationship? Men are from Mars, women are from? Yeah. So you can even talk about it along those lines if you want to apply it that way. The idea is Jesus is breaking down those dividing walls of hostility. And he's saying, I want you to reflect that same movement in your community life. So, not only is the church a peacemaking body, the church is a reconciled diversity. The key word here is reconciliation. Reconciliation is related to peace. Peace is the general goal, but reconciliation is the focus of reconciliation is to restore relationships. So if peace here breaks down barriers, reconciliation rebuilds the relationships. He says here, the purpose of Jesus was to create in himself one new humanity out of the two, thus making peace in the one body to reconcile both of them, Jew and Gentile, to God through the cross. So Jesus not only breaks down the barriers to peace, he does so in order to create something brand new. Now watch, little Greek word study here, or lesson here. The word for new in this passage, there are two words in general, okay, for new. The first word you'll find is neos. Say neos. All right, neos. And neos speaks of something that is new as it relates to time. Okay, so it would be like the latest version of something. All right, so like if you said, hey man, I got a brand new iPhone 5, right? You're saying that this is the latest version of the iPhone. Okay, so that's neos, neos. It's the latest version of the MacBook Pro. It's the latest edition of that best-selling book, right? It's the latest Ford Focus. Those of you who drive a Ford Focus. Now, the other word that you'll find for new is kainos. Say kainos. Kainos is a different kind of new, okay? It's new in relation to its kind. So it would be like a brand new invention. Right? So while neos would be your latest iPhone 5, kainos, watch this, would be the original cell phone that was created back in 1973 by a guy by the name of Martin Cooper. You get it? iPhone is the latest edition of the cellular phone, so to speak. Kainos, that's neos. Kainos is, this is the original invention. When it was brand new. You feel me? Alright, let me do one more. Neos, okay, neos would be the latest Ford Focus model to come out, 2014 or 13, whatever it is. Right?
That's neos. This is the latest edition. Kainos would be the Ford Model T, the first ever invented automobile. How many of you have ever driven one of those?
Just kidding. All
right. Okay, I think you get it. Now watch this. Paul says, Jesus Christ died to create out of the two one new man, or one new kainos, humanity. And this humanity looks like Jew and Gentile coming together as a brand new invention. In other words, Jesus Christ died to create a community that the world has never seen before. Jew and Gentile, worshiping under the same roof, loving one another, worshiping together, sharing meals together. In ancient history, there was no paradigm for that. That was brand new. That was kindness. And the tragedy of the American church, and probably other churches in other parts of the world too, is that one of the deepest stains in our history as a country, folks, and you just need to know this, is that we've tried to rebuild what Christ has broken down. We've been trying to rebuild this dividing wall of hostility. This is in our history. You know, as a Pentecostal church, let me share one example. As a Pentecostal church, right? The Pentecostal movement began back in early 1900s with this event called the Azusa Street Revival. Some of you know about this. You know the Azusa Street Revival? Right here in Los Angeles, man. Bonnie Gray Street. You know who was at the center of that renewal, that revival, that outpouring of the Holy Spirit? A poor, black, uneducated preacher, African-American dude named William Seymour. He shows up to L.A., Bonnie Gray Street on that house. He didn't have a whole lot of education. Right? He comes from, you know, wherever he came from in the South. And he starts leading this movement. The Holy Spirit falls. And all of a sudden, you've got all these different meetings popping up all over the city of Los Angeles and beyond where people are speaking in tongues. This is the birthplace of the Assemblies of God, the Four Square Movement, the Church of God, Pentecostal branch. And wonderful things are happening, all because of an African and American dude who came from the South who believed and obeyed God. Now, here's the unfortunate turn everything took. As the years went on and the revival started to kind of grow to a close, the Pentecostal movement split in two along racial lines. There was a black branch and there was a white branch. Assemblies of God became one of the primary white branches of the Pentecostal movement. And several years ago, they repented of all of that stuff. But then you had a black branch happen. And all of a sudden, when you look at, hey, who are the Pentecostals? You can see absolute segregation if you looked at it from a large picture across the nation. Very sad thing. Very sad thing. Oh, you say, well, Pastor, that don't happen today. Well, Martin Luther King Jr. said way back then, he said, the most segregated hour in America is Sunday morning at 11 o'clock. He said, no, that can't be anymore, Pastor. We got a black president, for Christ's sake. Let me tell you, it still rings true. Let me give you proof. When sociologists, church growth people, started doing studies on the multi-ethnic churches in America, they had to come up with a definition for what a multi-ethnic church looks like. And so they used the 80-20 rule. They basically said, if a church has over 80% one ethnicity attending, okay, as a core membership, then that is not a multi-ethnic church. It has over 80%, okay? If it has 80% or less of one ethnicity, then we'll call that a multi-ethnic church. So, and a multi-ethnic church in their mind was a church that had 20% diversity, okay? Now this applies to all ethnicities, white, black, Filipino, Asian, Latino, you name it. They did a study across America. Look, nearly 300,000 congregations meet in America and claim some kind of religious affiliation. We're not even talking Christian, okay? This is Christianity, this is Muslim, this is Jewish, this is Mormon. All across the nation, 300,000 congregations gather together weekly. They did a study and they measured, they said, based on the 80-20 rule,
How many of these congregations are multi-ethnic? You know what the percentage was? 300,000 churches. 7.5% of those 300,000 churches are multi-ethnic. Now watch. Take all the other religious affiliations out. Let's just do Christianity. When you just measure the Christian congregations across America who worship Jesus and say, we're all one in Christ, they measure the number of multi-ethnic Christian congregations, and guess what? The number, the percentage, fell from 7.5 to about 2 or 3%. This is recent, folks. Okay? So basically, this is what this says. Now you can question the metric and all that, whatever. But this is what this says. The norm in the country of America, in the United States, the norm is for someone to be attending either an all-white, an all-black, an all-Asian, or an all-Latino, or an all-whatever ethnicity church. And what I'm saying is that if we're going to take what Paul is saying seriously, that the nature of the church is a reconciled diversity, then we need to ask the question, why are we not becoming more multi-ethnic? I'll tell you why in a word. It's hard. We're dealing with this issue at Harbor City right now, folks. How do we integrate the Spanish-speaking people at Harbor City? They speak a different language. I get it. I know there's issues. But it's really tough. And it's tough to love each other across our cultural differences. It's much more easier to grow the church using homogeneous unit principle and say, just grow the church, make people, get people who are like us, who eat our food, who like what we like, who are the same social class and social status as we are, then we can grow the church much more quickly. And it's true, it's proven. But listen, in the cities of America, that I don't believe is being faithful to the gospel. Especially as Paul is talking about, there is no Jew, no Greek, no slave, no free. The barriers have fallen down. The church needs to be a demonstration of the kingdom of God in society, what the kingdom is called to do, which is to bring peace and shalom. And if we can't show that in our congregational life, then the message of the gospel that we preach loses credibility in the eyes of people in the world. Does that make sense? All right, I'm just talking. He said, Ken, you're on your soapbox talking about multicultural and that. I say, yeah, it's my passion. And it's my passion, honestly, because I've seen in Scripture how we're not called to just be a single ethnicity. No church that exists today that names the name of Jesus is called to just be a single ethnicity. Or even a single social class. That's a whole different topic altogether. They may be a single ethnicity, but they may be multicultural, but only one social class. No, there's something about the poor that God says, you can't forget them. This is tough, folks. All right, so let me slice it another way. You ready? Take a deep breath, folks. All right, let me slice it another way. If the church is to be a reconciled diversity, okay? If we're called to be peacemakers, which we are, then perhaps there are other things that divide us rather than just race and ethnicity and generational differences, right? Well, actually, that's a big one, especially for our church. Generational differences. Parents coming from another, coming from the homeland, right? You're all here. I don't get my son or daughter, man. They don't show respect anymore, man. I'm going to send them back home to the Philippines. I've seen that happen a lot of times. Right? You probably better, right? Forget that. I'm sending them back home because, man, America is toxic. And I get it. I agree. They're growing up different, folks. Seriously. And in the church, we've got to find a way to remove the walls of hostility between generations, don't we? Yeah, that's a big one. But see, here's the idea. I can't expect you to get along with somebody who looks different than you, who eats different food than you, who speaks a different language than you. I can't expect you to get along with that person in the church if you can't get along with your own spouse. Am I right? I get it, man. I know, Pastor, you're talking about how do I be more sensitive to other cultures. I can't even get along with my wife. So let's start where it's practical.
Your marriage is a cross-cultural relationship. Everything you learn at the cross-cultural meeting, apply it to your marriage. Your kids, cross-cultural relationship, man. Yeah. You need to start getting into their world, speaking their language. Same with your spouse, too. Because there are dividing walls of hostility, even within the family system. Would you agree?
Yes.
All right, so that slice a little bit better. The church is a reconciled diversity, man. Let's stop building the wall that Jesus has already torn down. All right. You want to react like that? I'm going to keep going. Last point, and then I'm done. The church, the nature of the church, is a place of God's dwelling, a visible sign of God's presence in the world. Jesus says, or Paul says here, in him the whole building is joined together and rises to become a holy temple in the Lord. And in him you too are being built together to become a dwelling in which God lives by his Spirit. So here's the idea. The church is not primarily an institution. It's not primarily an organization. It is the people who reflect the visible sign of God's presence in their community life. You, us together, are a sign to the world of God's presence. We make God visible to the world. So if the world